Hello and welcome to the session in which we will introduce inventory. Specifically, we're going to be introducing the concept of periodic versus perpetual inventory system. Inventory is a major topic in intermediate accounting as well as the CPA exam. This is the first session of a multiple session that's going to discuss the inventory. It could be 10 to 12 sessions discussing this topic because it's an important topic, whether you are an accounting student or studying for the CPA exam. Whether you are an accounting student or studying for the CPA exam, I strongly suggest you take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. I don't replace your CPA review course. I am a useful addition to your CPA review course. I provide you alternative explanation. I will show you the theory behind the concept of understanding the material, which in turn will help you add 10 to 15 points to your CPA exam. Your risk is 1 month of subscription. Your potential gain is passing the exam. This is a list of my course catalog. I have intermediate accounting, auditing, governmental accounting, advanced accounting. I have a lot of resources, multiple choice, true, false exercises. My CPA supplemental resources are aligned with your Becker, Wiley, Roger, Gleam, or any other CPA course you are taking. So it's very easy to switch between, to go back and forth between your CPA review course and my supplemental material. I also give you access to all the AI CPA previously released questions, almost 1,500 questions with detailed solution in addition to thousands of CPA questions. If you have not connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation. Like this recording, share it with other, connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. So what is inventory? Well, inventory are items held for sale in the normal course of operation. Simply put, inventory is something that usually you would buy or you would manufacture and you present for the customers for sale. So it's an asset. Specifically, it's a current asset. Why is it an asset? Well, when you sell it, the assumption is you're going to be making a profit. Well, it's an asset because assets, the definition of an asset, is something that's going to provide you future benefit. The assumption is you will sell it at a higher than its cost. Also, it's a current asset because you expect to sell it in the near future. So when you have an asset like inventory, you don't want to sit on it for any period of time. You want to sell it immediately if you can. So that's why it's a current asset. Inventory can be purchased, and if it's a purchase, it's very easy to account for. You have one account called usually merchandise inventory, or for short, just inventory. Or inventory could be manufactured. For manufacturing companies, we could see three types of inventory accounts, and those are raw material, work in process, and finished goods. And I have no doubt you looked at those accounts when you studied either cost accounting or managerial accounting. And companies like Ford Motor Company or companies that is manufacturing in nature will have those accounts. What is raw material? Raw material is, for example, for a Ford Motor Company, raw material will be the tires that are sitting in the warehouse. It will be the batteries that they're going to be installing in their cars. It will be the radios they're going to be installing in each vehicles. So that's raw material. They have not started the process yet. It's sitting in the warehouse. Work in process are not completed manufactured cars. So they are partially completed. So for example, at the end of the period, they will have a car that's 70% completed. Well, that's part of their inventory, but it's not completed. Finished goods are finished inventory, cars ready to be sold. So the inventory for a company like Ford Motor Company would involve raw material, work in process, and notice here they add supplies, which is usually it's part of raw material, and finished goods. But for a company like Walmart, they usually have one line, which is inventory. As we are starting to learn about inventory, we need to understand something called inventory cost flow. How does the inventory cost flow from a grand perspective? Well, let's assume a company that already existed. If a company has already existed at the beginning of the period, they might have some beginning inventory. So for simplicity, I'm going to be using units to illustrate this concept, not dollar amount, because we're going to get to this later on. Okay, we're going to get to the dollar amount in future session. I want to make sure you understand this picture very well because it's a powerful, powerful concept. So at the beginning, let's assume you open the store and from the prior periods, you are selling calculators. You had 10 calculators in beginning inventory. Then throughout the year, you purchased more calculators. Then you purchased an additional 90 calculator throughout the year. Well, what you started with is 10. Then you purchased another 90 units. Simply put, you had 100 units available for sale, 100 units available for sale, which are the calculator. You started with 10, purchase 90, you have 100 units available. At the end of the period, what's going to happen is this. Some of these units will stay in ending inventory. So if you did not sell those calculators, they're going to stay in ending inventory. So we're going to assume that your ending inventory consists of 20 units. And if your ending inventory consists of 20 units, we would assume that you sold, the remainder was sold, and you sold 80 units. Few things I want to point out here. One, the first thing, your beginning inventory plus your purchases will give you something, cost of goods available for sale. Here what I did not use the dollar amount because I don't want to complicate matter yet. I just want to use units. Simply put, you had 100 units. Now, if you assuming each unit for $10, you can multiply it by $10, but it doesn't matter. So those are the goods. So we can eliminate the cost here because we're using unit. Goods available for sale, you had 100 units. When you counted your inventory, you find out you had 20 units remaining. If you have 20 units remaining, it means 80 were sold. When you sell inventory, it becomes cost of goods sold. Now, the other thing I want to point out is this. If you had 25 units remaining, it means you sold 75. If you had 10 units remaining, it means you sold 90. So notice what's happening, the relationship between those ending inventory and cost of goods sold. There's a negative relationship between those two. If ending inventory is higher, cost of goods sold is lower. If ending inventory is lower, it's going to be in cost of goods sold. There's a negative relationship. And this is an important concept that we need to understand for later. It's a negative relationship. And simply put, ending inventory plus cost of goods sold, they can go backward and they will give us also cost of goods available for sale. So whatever we sold and whatever we have left is what we had in total available. So notice, beginning inventory and purchases gives you this number, cost of goods available for sale. Also, ending inventory and cost of goods sold, can we work with it backward. This is an important concept, important computation here that we are going to be using later when we deal with FIFO, LIFO, weighted average, and other inventory cost flow method. Now let's dive into perpetual versus periodic. What is the difference between perpetual versus periodic? Well, there are two ways to account for your inventory as you're selling inventory. We're going to look at the perpetual first, then we'll look at the periodic. Then we'll work a short example. Perpetual. Perpetual means you are continuously updating the inventory record. Think of a perpetual as a computerized system or a smart system where you are using technology to keep track of all your purchases, of all your sales, of all your purchase discounts, of all your purchase return. So simply put, when you make a purchase, you debit the purchase to inventory. So everything is accounted for in an inventory account. Simply put, so you will have an inventory account. And when you purchase something, you debit inventory for the cost of that inventory. If you paid for transportation, to transport this inventory, you would also add it to the inventory. So transportation, freight in, transportation, it's added to the inventory. If you have any purchase returns and allowances, there are a reduction in your inventory. You would credit inventory. So everything is updated through inventory. It's a smart system. Cost of goods sold is updated with each sales while reducing inventory. So simply put, when you make a sale, you would reduce your inventory and it goes from inventory. Whatever you reduce in inventory, it becomes cost of goods sold. So simply put, it goes into cost of goods sold and you're accounting for cost of goods sold also perpetually, also live as you are selling. And you're going to keep a subledger of each individual inventory item on hand. So you'll also have you would have a subledger to keep track of this. This is a perpetual inventory system. And don't worry, we're going to be working examples, short example next, then more examples later. Periodic inventory system is inventory recorded or updated periodically, as the word periodic. It means every once in a while. It's a manual system. When do you update the inventory is when you do a count. When you do a count periodically, this is why it's called periodically. When you make a purchase, you're going to be debiting an account called purchases. So rather than inventory, what's going to happen is when you make a purchase, you would keep track of those purchases in a purchase account rather than inventory. If you have any purchase discounts and returns, you will have another account called purchase discount, and you will have another account called purchase return. I'm writing very small, purchase return. So you'll have these accounts separately. So you'll have more accounts to account for those purchase discounts and return. Versus in the perpetual, you increase and decrease inventory. Purchases and beginning inventory at the end are closed. You close them, and specifically you sum them all and you close them to cost of goods sold. So how do we compute cost of goods sold under the periodic inventory system? We'll take all our purchases plus our beginning inventory, then we'll deduct ending inventory. And that's going to give us cost of goods sold. Something similar to what we looked at in the prior slide. On the prior slide, if you remember, we looked at this relationship between those accounts. And this is basically how it works. But the concept is the same. Cost of goods available for sale, whether it's periodic or perpetual, it has to be split between ending inventory and cost of goods sold. Now, the best way to kind of make some sense of this method is to actually work in a short example, illustrating the main concept. We're going to be diving more into this concept later on. So let's take a look at this simple example to illustrate the perpetual, how to account for these transactions, perpetual versus periodic. Our beginning inventory happens to be 200 units, and we purchased them at $6. And our total beginning inventory is 1,200. That's fine. That's our beginning inventory. We're starting with that. Then we made a purchase. We purchased 700 units, also at $6. Well, under a perpetual inventory system, we will debit inventory and we will credit accounts payable. Under the periodic inventory system, we'll debit an account called purchases and we credit accounts payable. So notice the difference. And remember, periodic purchases. So if you want to remember which account to debit. Then we made a sale. We sold 800 units at $10. Well, we're going to debit account receivable for $8,000. We're going to credit sales for $8,000. Then we're going to reduce our inventory. We sold 800 units, and we only have the cost. I kept it simple. The cost of all the units is $6. Therefore, we reduce our unit 800 unit, which is 4,800. And what we do, this 800, the 800 unit that are sold, they become, we debit cost of goods sold. So notice what happened is we are matching the cost to the sale. So as we make a sale, we are matching the related cost. Under the periodic inventory system, we only have one entry. And what I mean by one entry, only the sale. We debit account receivable, we credit sales. We don't have the second entry. Why? Because under the perpetual, we have two entries, the sale and the cost of the sale. Under the periodic, we are not keeping track of our inventory nor our cost of goods sold, but perpetual we are. Periodic is, you don't worry about this later, we'll account for this later. Ending period, at the end of the period, we had 100 units remaining. Simply put, we started with 200, we purchased 700, 200 plus 700 is 900. Then we sold 800. We still have 100 units left. Well, if we have 100 units left under the perpetual inventory system, we can easily account for our inventory. We started with 1,200. This is what we started with. We purchased 4,200. It's right here. Then we reduced our inventory by 4,800. So everything is accounted for. Cost, ending inventory is 600. There's no journal entry to be made because we are keeping track of our ending inventory. And cost of goods sold, also we don't need to do anything because cost of goods sold, we are keeping track of our cost of goods sold. Under the periodic inventory system, it's going to be different. Under the periodic inventory system, we're going to count inventory and it's going to tell us we have 100 units and the cost of those 100 units is $6. The first thing we do is we establish ending inventory. So we establish ending inventory at 600. Now we need to remove purchases and beginning inventory because those are temporary account. We need to get rid of them. So we credit purchases 4,200. So to get rid of purchases, we credit beginning inventory, which the 1,200 coming from here, beginning inventory, we have to get rid of those. Cost of goods sold becomes a plug. And basically all what we did is we took to compute cost of goods sold. We took beginning inventory. We can do it going through beginning inventory, 1,200 plus purchases. The purchases were 4,200 this is going to give us 5,400 minus 5,400 minus ending inventory. Ending inventory is 600. Ending inventory is 600, and that's going to give us 4,800, which is the same as perpetual, but we account for it differently. Under the perpetual, cost of goods sold was accounted for as we are processing the transaction. Now, one more thing I want to mention in this session is inventory adjustment. When the inventory count differ from the perpetual inventory system, yes, although we have a perpetual inventory system, we are still going to count the inventory. And differences could occur due to theft, breakage, shrinkage, incorrect record keeping. So we could have a difference. So the best way is to illustrate this concept. Let's assume the perpetual inventory record, which is the computer system, show a balance of 85,600, but the inventory count established the inventory balance to be 85,000. Well, the computer system is saying we should have 85,600. We did the count and it's only 85,000. Well, what do we have to do? We have to reduce our inventory by 600. So what we do is we debit an account called inventory over short for $600, and we credit inventory for $600 to reduce inventory. Now, we could also close it to cost of goods sold. If the amount is not material, we usually close it to cost of goods sold. Most textbooks close it to cost of goods sold. Now, even if you did this inventory cash over and short, you might also close it to cost of goods sold. But if the amount is material, what you have to do is you have to have a separate line. If the amount is material, and the amount should not be material, you should not have those inventory shortage. That's going to be a large amount that would require its own line or be reported separately under other revenues or other losses and expenses. It should not. In a periodic inventory system, this number is buried in cost of goods sold. So periodic inventory system buries the shortage, whatever shortage you have, into cost of goods sold. And the simple is when you do the count under the periodic inventory system, you are not comparing your count to anything else. You're just doing the count. Therefore, you have nothing to compare to. Therefore, you just debit. So simply put, under a periodic inventory system, you will debit automatically cost of goods sold. Most likely in your textbook, most likely on the CPA exam, you will close it to cost of goods sold because the amount usually is not material. Now, in the next session, what we would look at is determining the cost of goods sold. What goes into the cost of inventory, not cost of goods sold. At the end of this recording, I'm going to remind you, whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, to take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. I can help you increase your score. I can help you increase your CPA exam score along working with your CPA review course. I don't replace your CPA review course. Give me a try. It's a month. Give it a try. You like it, you keep it. You feel it's making a difference, you keep it. If not, you cancel. It's an investment. The CPA is worth it. Study hard.